presidential pets with superpowers that dealt with everything from overgrown bugs to werewolves to breaking all concepts of time travel. This short-lived show was one of the weirdest things I've revisited at Nerdwire, with lots of loose ends and some downright disturbing moments. Hit that subscribe button and bell and step away from the toilet water. I'm Chris Carr, and on today's nostalgia trip, we're taking you back to Road Rovers. Before we dive in, I want to give a shout out to our super nerd sponsor of the day, Logan Clad. Thanks to heroes like Logan, I get to keep talking about cartoons of days past with y'all, so thank you so much. If you'd like to chip in, head on over to our Patreon page and see if a donation tier works for you. All right, let's talk about the power of the pack.
I want you to greet the members of your pack.
Yes, sir!
Well, hi.
Hello.
Road Rovers follows five dogs who, thanks to the marvels of science, are placed in a transmogrifier and turned into Kano sapiens with superpowers. Each powered pup lives with a world leader and, when called to action, uses an elaborate underground slide system to once again don their Road Rover facade. The Rovers are created by Professor Shepard, who, after being double-crossed by a blackmailer who kidnapped his dog, lives underground in a hydrant city and somehow seems to be able to telepathically communicate with his dogs. This will never be explained. His glowing eyes are, though. That's just special effects, kids. The leader of our pack is Hunter, some sort of golden retriever mix with super speed and the catchphrase, "Yet another unexpected twist." Bummer. There's Colleen the Collie, who resides in England and is an expert in martial arts, typically yelling out food items or celebrity names as she kicks and punches. Exile is from Siberia, and this husky has laser vision and freezing vision. He's constantly telling Doberman Blitz of Germany to not be a weird boy. Blitz is vain, cowardly, and obsessed with biting butts.
It's not fair. I wanted to bite his tuchus first.
There's also an ongoing gag of Colleen not remembering who he is and messing up his name. Our last rover is Shag, a sheepdog who lives in Switzerland who, despite his super strength, is meek and timid. He has a massive appetite and is always pulling food out from beneath his fur. He's also the only rover who didn't gain the ability to speak like a human. In addition to the rovers, we have Muzzle. Muzzle is truly the only character I remembered about this show. I vividly remember him just bouncing up and down in the end credits. When the dogs are initially called or chosen to be rovers, Hunter and Muzzle are about to be euthanized at the pound. That's right. On this Saturday morning children's cartoon, the writers were like, let's remind kids that dogs get put down if they've been at the pound for over 6 weeks. Let's show a terrifying gas chamber. Let's have the workers who perform the euthanasia seem really, really annoyed that these dogs don't want to die. Hunter escapes, and the mysterious voice telling him to come to be a road roper also tells him to leave Muzzle behind to be put down. Hunter, being a good boy, of course goes back and saves his friend. Muzzle will almost always remain muzzled, though, bouncing around in his Hannibal Lecter straitjacket and muzzle. The dog remains completely unhinged and used as a final resort against villains. It is heavily implied that Muzzle is straight up eating people, or at least parts of them. We learn in episode 1, though, that Muzzle isn't just some random stray. He is, in fact, the professor's dog Scout that was stolen from him. Yet, Muzzle will remain being called Muzzle. Also, Professor, you gave up a government-funded project to a terrorist over this dog. And now you're like, nah, he can get put down. No biggie, Hunter.
Leave, Hunter. Save yourself while you still can.
Oh, the difference a year makes. That's cold. So when they're reunited, it doesn't feel sweet. It just feels weird. Especially since he keeps the dog strapped to a gurney. The plot of this show is all over the place. Like, the world leaders don't seem to know that their dogs are these superheroes, yet we see the UN send the dogs out for missions. They're featured in newspapers. I know I shouldn't expect a lot of consistency from a 90s cartoon, but come on. The bar is set so high now, I need a few things to make sense when I watch a cartoon. The biggest WTF moment for me, the origin of the series' main villain, General Parvo. Voiced by, you guessed it, Jim Cummings. I should just start giving Jim Cummings money each month directly instead of having him collect residuals from these old shows. Let's look at that name, Parvo. This is both a fitting and truly horrific name to give a villain in a dog show. Parvo is a highly contagious virus that causes a GI illness in pups and has an immensely high mortality rate. The virus spreads through either direct contact with an infected dog or through contact with fecal matter. This is typically a death sentence for puppies, so bestowing such a sinister name for their foe was an inspired and troubling move. When discussing with his cohort and potentially his lover, I don't know, jury's out on it, the groomer, this lady who, well, okay, she's a groomer. She's just a groomer. She cuts fur, she carries around a little buzzer. She's a groomer. So when he's talking to her about his distrust of cats, he reveals that he is in fact not a human, but a mutant himself. He was a cat, and he's trying to become a full-fledged man. All right, so Parvo's goals. World domination. Become a man. Are these the hopes and dreams of all cats? In an episode where the Rovers are chasing Parvo through space for reasons, Parvo and the groomer come in contact with a black hole. They use its power to build a time machine. Because cats is smart. Right next to the time machine, though, is the transmogrifier thing that Parvo has been using to treat his body to try and become more human. The thing goes haywire, and Parvo is accidentally transformed back into a cat, and then he's accidentally transported to the past. This is why you keep your time machine in its own separate room, kids. Mistakes happen. So Kitty Parvo returns to the past, 8 years ago to be precise, right before Shepard and his lab are blown up and he goes into hiding. Kitty Parvo ends up at Shepard's house, and the professor takes in the stray, noting that his kids will love this little cat that he's decided to name Boots. Time out. The professor has a family? Do they know he's living in an underground hydrant palace? Now, Shepard's money is all about making money off of the transmogrifier, not bettering humanity through it, somehow. So he swings by Shepard's place to dognap Scout and test the machine on the pooch for a prospective buyer. He instead grabs Boots. Boots becomes the kitty man that we all know. Then the groomer is able to pinpoint Parvo in time, travel back to him, and bestow the name General Parvo onto him. And she helps him plot to steal a transmogrifier from Shepard by kidnapping Scout. They also place Scout in the device, which just makes him go berserk. So they're the reason he becomes Muzzle. The Rovers also travel back in time briefly, but are transported back home somehow by the professor to present day. But not before Shag can mail the professor a letter that Parvo will double-cross him, leading the professor's life to be saved. Confused? Of course you are! What is this plot? Shepard's device created Parvo, but only after Parvo had already existed as Parvo in the future? Blah! And Shepard has been eyeing these dogs for years as his recruits? For 8 years? That's 56 dog years! All these recruits are 56 at the end of the show! Wouldn't you pivot towards a younger pup instead of trying to teach an old dog new tricks? Also, Shepard, bro, where is your family? Was this all an elaborate way to ditch your wife and kids? What happened to them? You clearly have a love of dogs that's leaning real hard towards obsession. Did they find you problematic? What went down here? Road Rovers ran for just one season from 1996 to 1997 as part of the Kids WB lineup. So to get a feel for the type of humor it was sandwiched between, that's when we had Pinky and the Brain, Freakazoid, and Animaniacs on the air. This makes the humor that Road Rovers tried to implement make a bit more sense. There's lots of political and pop culture references, recurring gags, breaking of the fourth wall, and even some of that classic WB womp womp music that was recycled in their episodes. I think the show implementing irony, verbal humor, and situational humor aimed at adults may have been its undoing. I feel like it wasn't just trying too hard, it was trying everything. And so nothing really landed. This could have turned folks off from the show. Others think it was done in by angry parents. One episode featured the now infamous Russian name song, a sort of naming of cats ode to picking out a name, which included a verse that was meant to sound like the dogs were saying son of a bitch. So some have theorized that that song could have specifically led to the show being pulled. Others have theorized that merchandising is simply the cause, and that no retailers were interested in making Road Rover toys. I will say though, I learned that theory from Wikifur, which is apparently Wikipedia for furries, so I'm not sure about the credibility of that one. Also, wow, this show has a big ol' furry following. People are really into Colleen. Google showed me some weird stuff this week. Thank you for that, producer Brett. Thank you so much. While this is definitely a show I don't recommend you hunt down old DVDs for, I gotta say, watching this weird little series was a pretty hilarious break from reality. Most global crises boiled down to a misunderstanding that man's best friend could solve. Did my brain feel like it was melting when paradoxes would pop up? You bet your sweet bippy. But this weird show was a welcome palate cleanser. Also, it was a lovely reminder that I am totally justified in my complete distrust of cats. They're all just megalomaniacs in the making. Of course, these are just my thoughts on Road Rovers. Did you grow up with the show? Is it as weird as you remember? Do you think its sense of humor just didn't land with audiences? Hit me with your hot takes in the comments below, and make sure you're subscribed for next week's trip to the creme de la creme of Kids WB, Animaniacs. Thanks again to all of our donors on Patreon, and thank you for watching. Until the next detour, I'll see you, Space Cowboy.